What's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of the Fundamentals of Investing podcast. In today's episode, we're going to be discussing SoFi's second quarter earnings, where the stock is down 15%. I'm going to explain why and share some of my thoughts with regards to their segments, their growth, what's happening with the company, and why they're down so much. So this is my fourth recording, I think, all tonight because I'm going on vacation for the next couple of weeks. So bear with me on this one. I was actually really interested to read SoFi's results and compile some thoughts in this document. It might be a longer video compared to some of the other ones, but SoFi is a big holding of mine and it's something that I've been really bullish on for quite a while. And the company beat on the top line, coming in at $237 million. In terms of quarterly revenue versus $231 million expected by analysts. And they missed on EPS actually by a big amount, negative 48 cents versus negative 4 cents that analysts were expecting. There is reasoning behind this, which we're going to dive into. But let's start first with some remarks from the CEO. Anthony Noto highlighted that the second quarter proved to be another quarter full of milestones for SoFi. They exceeded financial expectations, delivering record adjusted quarterly net revenue and fourth consecutive quarter of positive adjusted EBITDA. We accomplished all of this by focusing on our members and our mission to provide them with the right financial products, services, and advice for every major financial decision in their lives and every day in between. Two metrics that they really track closely are members and products, and both of those, no surprise here, are up over 100%. SoFi has been delivering consistently results over 100%. And these numbers have been accelerating for quite a long time for these metrics. So products is up to 3.6 million products versus 1.6 million in Q2 of 2020, up 123%. And members, 2.5 million members versus the 1.2 million members in the second quarter of 2020, up 113%. For Galileo, they're up 119%. 79 million accounts in Galileo versus 36 million in the second quarter of 2020. We're going to break out both segments and talk about each of them, but both of these segments are up by big amounts. Lending products is a little bit weaker, but financial products is definitely rising very quickly. We saw in Q3 of 2020, financial products really overtake lending products. And ever since that time, it's just been explosive growth. It's a little bit easy to get lost in all of the numbers that SoFi provided. So I'm breaking it out into chunks and concluding the growth numbers before I get even into the segments in the financials. Members, 113%, products, 129%, Galileo, 119%. Membership growth has been accelerating 8 quarters in a row, and product growth has been accelerating 7 quarters in a row. This is not the growth is consistently higher. It's accelerating growth. They're doing a higher level of growth every quarter, more so than the last. That's insanely bullish to see. Lending segment is up 13% year over year, and financial segment is up 243% year over year. So the company definitely does not have a growth problem at all. They have two major segments. They have lending, where they provide home loans, personal loans, and student loans, which you can see in the gray bar here. And the segment that's really been exploding is financial services, where they have SoFi Money, they have SoFi Invest, essentially a competitor to Robinhood with this product. They have their own credit cards, they have Relay, they have SoFi at Work. And this in the blue bar is highlighted here, the financial services products growth. Absolutely amazing growth numbers. And so how we're going to break out this video is by first talking about lending. So new originations or issuing new loans, talking about their existing cohort growth, the retention rates, their lifetime values, profitability. And then we're going to jump into financial services and talk a little bit about their product growth, talk about Galileo, talk about their numbers as well. And then we're going to wrap everything up at the end. So in terms of lending products, SoFi has had several headwinds. And this is one of the reasons why they missed EPS, which we're going to cover. This year, they've introduced the rate match guarantee feature for student loans. They've introduced a snooze feature that allows borrowers to lock in current low rates. In personal loans, they've refined credit policy and automation capabilities, which basically creates a faster and more accurate, lower touch automated experience. More than 50% of personal loans processed in the second quarter were fully automated. This is up from less than 30% a year ago. So they're becoming smarter in how they're processing these loans, and they're introducing more automation, which reduces the time to fund by 50% to 2 days. This is absolutely fantastic because you want to be able to make this process as seamless as possible for those individuals getting new loans from SoFi. In terms of home loans, they introduced a new rates calculator to help borrowers find the right loan for them. And the combination of all of these enhancements, the return to more normalized credit qualification standards, and increased marketing in a favorable rate environment contributed to double-digit year-over-year growth across every loan type in the second quarter of 2021. With home loans, their historically smallest category, increasing 72%, which is to be expected, right? If it's super small, generally speaking, it's going to grow faster than other segments. Personal loans, which is their largest segment of lending, increased 15% to 544,000. And student loans increased 11% for a total blended aggregate of 14% in lending product increases year over year. In terms of the new origination, so an origination is just them issuing a new loan. So think of originations as new customers onboarding onto the SoFi platform or new users onto the platform itself. In the second quarter, the total origination volume in the lending segment increased to 66% year over year, while the growth in student loans remains depressed relative to pre-COVID levels. Low rates and improving U.S. economic trends have allowed SoFi to return to more normalized credit qualification standards. And this is what led to an increase in personal and home loan funding volumes, which were up 188% and 49% respectively year over year. So all lending segments are growing: home loans, personal loans, and student loans, not only from a total volume perspective of the products that they actually offer, but from a dollar value as well. Home loans grew 49%. Personal loans, which is their smallest segment, grew 188% and is now their largest segment as of this quarter. And student loans grew 9% as well, which is their second largest segment. All of this was blended into an aggregate 66% year over year. So now let's look at some of the financials of the lending segment. Net revenues were $166 million on a GAAP basis and $172 million on an adjusted basis for the second quarter of 2021, which increased 73% and 47% respectively year over year, driven by higher origination volume in every type of loan SoFi offers, meaning they onboarded a lot more people or they issued a lot more new loans, which we saw here. Lending segment contribution profit of $89.2 million increased 80% year over year in the second quarter of 2021 due to the combination of revenue growth and strategic balance sheet management. So for the first half of 2020, SoFi did about $95 million in total lending net revenue. And that number is up 73% here to $166 million net revenue for the lending segment. I'm going to skip some of these smaller numbers just because they're super small in comparison and we have a lot to get through in this deck, and jump straight into the attributable expenses, which are actually up 23% from $67 million to $83 million in terms of expenses. This was due to a reinvestment in the business, which Anthony Noto talked about in the conference call, and they highlighted in the actual press release as well, which is going to be attached in the description below. However, the contribution profit was up 80% from $49 million to $89 million. And once you add all of this stuff up, the adjusted net revenue for the lending segment is up 47% from $117 million to $172 million. This business is growing very fast. So 47% might be, you know, one of the lower numbers that you get in terms of the growth rate, because the majority of their numbers are over 100% for SoFi's growth, but still 47% is absolutely fantastic to have year over year for the lending segment, because it's traditionally their slower segment, right? Now we're going to get into the financial services segment, which is even faster than this. In terms of the financial segment, I've summarized some highlights that are straight from the press release, just so that you don't have to read through paragraphs and paragraphs. I've highlighted them into some bullet points. So first and foremost, SoFi sells financial services products three times more than they do lending products. One of the reasons for this is the huge amount of cross-selling in the financial services segment. Anthony Noto, their CEO, highlighted that this has increased 70% year over year in terms of cross-selling, meaning that if a user or a client or a customer uses one of their products, let's say their credit card, they are much more likely to use their other products. So the cross-selling opportunities speak to many things, but one of the things that it tells me is that SoFi's products are sticky from a customer perspective. Customers are satisfied with the quality of service that they receive from SoFi, and as a result, have a lot of cross-selling opportunities among different streams of their products. In terms of the SoFi Money segment, the company introduced early paycheck features. They introduced free overdraft protection and roundups, all features that have been, you know, become table stakes, I think, at this point by a lot of financial services companies. But the early paycheck feature, I think, was the most well received, at least on Twitter. People were really praising the company for that feature. I think it allows users to get paid up to 2 days before their actual paycheck comes in, which helps for them paying off expenses and bills and whatnot. A lot of the account growth that came for personal loans was due to this bundle between SoFi Money and the personal loan segment. So again, it talks to this cross-selling opportunities. They bundled their products together, which led to a lower average cost for the user, which made financial sense for that user to use two SoFi products instead of one, because they essentially got a discount, if you will. Also this quarter, SoFi expanded their crypto offerings. They expanded fractional shares and introduced one of the first ever weekly paying dividend ETFs. They introduced the SoFi credit card this year, which has been growing really fast. We're going to talk about that in just a second. And SoFi Relay has been surging in new members that are signing up for free credit score monitoring services. SoFi at Work partnerships have also grown as more and more companies are considering benefits for employees. SoFi at Work is actually one of their fastest growing segments, interestingly enough. However, it's a really small percentage of their total financial segment pie, which let's dive into that right now. We can see that the biggest segment is their invest segment, which has grown 216% from 328,000 where it was last year to over 1 million where it stands today. Now, their second biggest segment is no longer Relay, but it's actually the SoFi Money, from 220,000 all the way to 954,000, a 333% increase year over year. The Relay segment is the third largest segment, from 227,000 to 626,000, 176% year over year for that. At Work has also been increasing. And credit card, which they just introduced, is growing fast as well. This didn't exist in June of 2020. Now it has 42,000 products. So all in all, SoFi has almost tripled their product offerings on the financial services segment from 783,000 on June 30th, 2020, to 2.68 million in June 30th, 2021, a 243% increase in the segment products. And Galileo is something that also fits into the financial services segment. It's an infrastructure provider acquired by SoFi in May of 2020, and it's now grown to be a leader in internet-only neobank space, expanding now into non-financial sectors as well. Galileo is really the back end for a lot of these financial institutions. It's the back end that's used by Robinhood. It's the back end that's used by Chime and by many other companies. And all of this revenue comes to SoFi as the provider of this infrastructure. Galileo reported 79 million accounts, more than double the 36 million that they had last year, which we can see 119% increase here in the accounts that are using Galileo. They signed 22 new partners since the beginning of the year, and 12 of them were in the second quarter. This is versus 41 new clients that they had for the full year 2020. And no major partners have left the platform. Again, this talks to the retention, this talks to the stickiness and the dependence that a lot of these partners have on Galileo as a technology platform partner. In terms of the actual financials themselves, fantastic numbers, just like every other SoFi segment. Total net revenue for Galileo from 19 million here all the way up to 45 million, 138% increase. Expenses are up a whole bunch too. 367% increase in expenses, which led to a very slim contribution profit increase of 8% from 12 million to 13 million. And they explained these expenses by saying that they've invested to move operations from an on-premise environment to the cloud. They've invested to double their headcount and expand internationally. So the reason for these expenses is because the business is focusing on reinvesting back into the growth of Galileo as a platform, which, yes, it has a slower growth in the contribution profit, but we're going to see a more steady growth and even an acceleration of this growth in future quarters as a result of these expenses today, because eventually we're going to reap what we sow today in terms of attributable expenses. Like the headcount is going to come into play, the lower infrastructure costs, the international expansion, those are all going to benefit SoFi in terms of net revenue later on in the future. So the main thing that I really focus on Galileo's part is this top line growth, right? Again, with a lot of these growth companies, I attribute way higher significance to top line growth versus bottom line growth because the business just reinvests everything back into the growth of their platforms. So now that we've covered the actual product growth and Galileo's growth, let's talk about the revenues that come from the financial services segment. They highlight here that the company has experienced significant growth in this net revenue this year as members have responded positively to a steady stream of new offerings launched since 2019. Second quarter 2021 net revenue, 17 million, compares to 2.4 million in the second quarter of 2020. As you can see here, so 2.4 million in 2020 in total net revenue to 17 million today, 602% change in the financial services segment revenue. The largest driver of the revenue increase was SoFi Invest business, where we experienced a surge in new members and activity. Revenues from new equity capital markets and advisory services offerings were introduced during the quarter, contributed as well. If you'll remember at the beginning of the year, one of the biggest themes was people abandoning Robinhood and joining other brokerages like SoFi due to the GameStop AMC stuff that happened. This year has been a really big year for investing in general and younger generations investing in general. So I'm not surprised that SoFi Invest was one of the highest drivers of growth, not only from a product account perspective of new users, but also from a revenue perspective. The company highlighted that second quarter financial services segment contribution loss was 24.7 million, improved by 6.1 million from the prior year. However, they are still operating at a loss for this segment, which you can see here. They had a 33 million loss in 2020 versus a 2.4 million total net revenue. And they had 33 million in expenses here versus a 2.4 million net revenue. And today they have 41 million in expenses compared to 17 million in revenue. The variance of this, it makes up their contribution loss from 30 million down to 24 million down. But let's focus for a second on just the revenue growth. This was fueled on the strength of the offerings referenced above, more than offset the 8.5 million year-over-year increase in expenses, which were driven by ongoing investments to grow the business. At the same time, we are executing efficiently on our long-term strategy to increase member adoption of multiple products across segments, which reduces customer acquisition costs and ultimately drives higher lifetime value per member. This is an important point. We're going to circle back to the lifetime value per member because they highlighted this as well. But before we do that, let's talk a little bit about the guidance and the outlook, because they also covered, you know, one of the headwinds here of why they didn't raise their guidance, why they maintained their guidance, and why they actually missed EPS by such a big margin. They highlight here that their net revenue was 237 million, which exceeded the guidance of 215 to 220. Adjusted EBITDA of 11 million for the quarter exceeded quarterly guidance of negative 8 million to 2 million. They came in with 11 million. And management expects this continued strong growth in the third quarter of 2021 and expected adjusted net revenue of 245 million to 255 million. That's the range they're setting for the top line. And the range they're setting for the bottom line is negative 7 million in EBITDA to 3 million. One thing to keep in mind is that SoFi has been EBITDA positive now for several quarters, and I expect that trend to continue. So I think this negative 7 million to 3 million is a little bit of a sandbag, considering that they came in at 11 million despite headwinds in Q2. I think that they're going to come in at positive EBITDA for the next quarter as well, but we'll see. Management reiterates its full year 2021 guidance of adjusted net revenue of $980 million and adjusted EBITDA of $27 million. So they're going to be profitable this year, at least is the expectation, with about $1 billion in net revenue for the business. Keep in mind the company is only trading for, you know, about 11 or 12 billion as of today. So pretty good ratio there to have for net revenue versus market cap. And all of this is despite lowering the expectations for second half student loan refinancing revenue by $40 million due to the extension of the CARES Act moratorium on student loan payments from September 30th, 2021 to January 31st, 2022. So this was a headwind, this CARES Act extension, and reducing our technology platform revenue by $12 million due to the minority stake in Apex being bought back. So Apex bought back a stake that they had in SoFi. And as a result of that, the revenue estimate was reduced by SoFi, another headwind. But the thing is that both of these headwinds, the CARES Act extension and the Apex thing, were one-time headwinds, right? What isn't a one-time thing is the fact that they're accelerating their growth quarter over quarter. So that's why, you know, if I had to sum up my final thoughts on SoFi, I would say that yes, I understand that there are headwinds. Yes, it's justifiable why they're not making a profit on some of their revenue streams or why they missed EPS numbers for this quarter. But the fact of the matter remains that SoFi is having massive product growth in all of their segments, especially in their financial segment. They're having member growth and product growth accelerating quarter over quarter for the past 2 years. Member growth has been accelerating growth for 8 quarters and product growth has been accelerating for 7 quarters. The expansion of international offerings, they're having a strong product pipeline. As an example, Galileo surpassed $100 billion in annualized payment volume in July and is constantly adding new partners, while at the same time, they've never really lost a big partner. That speaks to the stickiness that they have, the dependence that other people have on the Galileo platform as a backend infrastructure. Their EBITDA margin has turned positive and has been positive for several quarters, and I expect it to end very strong. Their expectation for the full year was $27 million in terms of EBITDA. I think that's pretty safe. They're actually going to turn profit this year and become a sustainably growing, profitable company that's growing at over 100% in pretty much all their segments. That's absolutely mind-boggling to believe. And Anthony Noto, their CEO, highlighted that LTV continues to rise. So LTV is lifetime value. Think of this as all of the money that a user does with you over their entire lifespan using your products. Let me just break this down for a second. A lot of banks and financial services spend on average, I think, several hundreds, if not several thousands of dollars to acquire a new customer through marketing, through promotions, through campaigns. They do all that they can to get you to get a new credit card with that bank, open an account with that bank, get a mortgage or a home loan with that bank. And the reason why this customer acquisition cost is so high, right? The bank is spending money in terms of marketing dollars, in terms of expenses to win you over as a customer. The reason why it's so high is because traditionally speaking, financial services and banks have one of the highest lifetime values across multiple industries. Because generally speaking, if you sign up for a bank or a financial service when you're young, most often people don't change their financial service provider, right? So if I sign up for, let's say, JP Morgan Chase, chances are I'll be with JP Morgan for my whole life. And so the amount of lifetime value that I provide to JP Morgan in terms of, let's say, interest expenses, in terms of all of the things that I'm paying them for their services is much higher and makes up for this customer acquisition cost, okay? So that's essentially the stage that's set. Now we turn to SoFi, where their CEO highlights that, yes, we're increasing lifetime value. Basically, our existing users are doing more business with us and we're retaining those users for longer. But at the same time, our customer acquisition costs are falling due to the cross-selling opportunities. And how I interpret this is the products are so sticky and the products are so good and what they offer in terms of services are so good that they don't really have to do more marketing campaigns. They don't have to do, you know, more promotional gimmicks to win new users, because the moment that they hook a user in for one product, generally speaking, that user's not only not going to switch from SoFi to another institution, but they're actually going to ramp up how much money they do with SoFi, how many products that they have with SoFi. So definitely one of the most important points in this whole presentation, because this will turn that model on its head. To have a financial services institution with a low customer acquisition cost, they're not spending a lot of money to acquire new customers, with high lifetime value customers that increase the business that they're doing with SoFi as a business due to cross-selling. Like, that is the absolute, you know, golden scenario, the best thing that you can have if you're a financial services company. So I love that they're acknowledging this and that they're actually manifesting it and making it happen. So all of this is positive. All of their numbers are positive. I'm, you know, more bullish than ever on SoFi. And I think in terms of the negatives, the CARES Act was something that really hurt the company this quarter. And the Apex thing, sure, it hurt the company as well. Some other acquisitions hurt the company as well. But, you know, everything that I found that was negative, and I actually tried to sit down and look at this company from a bearish point of view. And I tried to argue all of the bearish points, and everything that I could find that was negative for SoFi this quarter was a one-time headwind. And if I think about that, it just makes me so confident in the company because of the fact that they're accelerating their growth, right? If you have one-time headwinds, yes, you're going to miss one earnings review here and there, but the fact that you have accelerating growth, you're setting yourself up for such a sustainable ride up that it's just a no-brainer. And so for the fact that SoFi fell 15% or so based on these earnings, based on the fact that they missed EPS, is absolutely ridiculous to me because of the fact that they're accelerating all the revenue growth. And I think that's the point that I really want to end on. I put out this tweet yesterday and basically I said, you know, Rocket Mortgage missed their revenue expectation. They missed their EPS. Tattooed Chef missed revenue expectation. They missed their EPS. They lowered their guidance. And these companies are, you know, one of them was up after hours and the other one is down less than SoFi is down. And then SoFi had over 100% beats in all of their major metrics, accelerating growth. All of their segments are growing. And the fact that today they're down 14%, you know, I just don't understand it. And I think Alex summed it up pretty well on Twitter here, where he said that bears instantaneously jump out when the situation isn't good to try to manipulate information to stir your emotions. This is exactly why I'm doing this video on SoFi and trying to present everything broken down by segment, because it's very easy to manipulate information like this to say, wait a minute, the company missed their EPS, the company had these huge headwinds, therefore they're not executing. If a company is growing in infrastructure and revenue, then there is still a bright future. So take a deep breath and calm down. And I was happy to read that because this was something that I needed to really hear. I was getting frustrated last night. And the reason why is because I knew that the earnings was fantastic, but I had a lot of call options in SoFi. I had a lot of leaps in SoFi. And so I have an equities position as well, but I think as a result of this volatility last night, I'm probably going to have a lot of those call options expire worthless, and I'm probably going to lose money on SoFi. And the reason I was frustrated about it wasn't because the stock fell, but it was because I was right about the company and it fell anyways. That's the risk with options. You can't really control the timing aspect of it, regardless if you're right or wrong. So, you know, that's a lesson that I'm sort of taking away, and I'm reallocating capital into SoFi. I'm still bullish on the company, right? But the fact that I was trying to time the company, assume that the market would behave in a logical and rational way. And as we saw with many companies this earnings quarter, it just hasn't. And so, yeah, like I'm happy to eat the cost of those call options expiring, which is kind of frustrating because I would rather be super wrong about a company and it turn out to, you know, be this huge disaster and then lose my call options rather than being right about a company and losing money regardless. So anyways, that's my tangent on that. All in all, I've never been more bullish on SoFi's products, on their segments, on their streams. And especially at this market cap, like, you know, do your own due diligence, do your own homework. But I think this is one of the best prices that we have for SoFi that we've seen this whole year. And this is also one of the best quarters that we've seen for SoFi since they became public companies. So everything coalesces into that. And that's just where I'll leave it, I think. This has been the Fundamentals of Investing podcast. Thank you so much for listening.